Here we go. Oh, I'm not even ready.
Good morning, church. I'm going to change things up a little bit. We're singing a song this morning that probably everybody here knows, the first choir song, is This Is Amazing Grace. I'm going to invite you to stand and sing and worship through this song with the choir this morning. When this song is over, you can be seated in case I forget to tell you. But if you would, stand with us and
Stronger, the King of Glory, the King. Sometimes on this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. And my story isn't over, my story's just begun. A failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my father does. Yeah, failure won't define me, 'cause that's what my father does. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house. Check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, here in the Father's house. Arrival's not the end game, the journey's where you are. You never wanted perfect, you just wanted my heart. And the story isn't over, if the story isn't good. A failure's never final when the Father's in the room. A failure's never final when the Father's in the room. Shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. The prodigals come home, the helpless find home. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room.
Of God really is that good this morning, isn't it, church? You know, I think about as we hear the words of that song about the prodigal son, and you just imagine the weight of shame that he must have felt as he walked down the road coming home to the Father's house, and, you know, then to experience the embrace of the Father. That's just, I don't know, that sends chill bumps all over me. So this morning, you know, we have experienced that grace, and God's grace is that good. And if you haven't experienced the grace of God, maybe you walked in here today and you have a weight of shame in your life, you can come and you can lay that burden down at the cross, because Jesus Christ became sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Therefore, the shame can be put away, and therefore there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And that's a promise we have today. If you're visiting here with us today for the first time, we're so glad that you're here. We do have a gift that we would like to give you. If you would, before you leave today, we have a Welcome Center desk out in our Welcome Center. Find that big desk in the Welcome Center. Go by there, introduce yourself, and they will give you a free gift before you leave. We'd love to be able to meet you. If you would stand with us today, church, we're going to read today from Psalm chapter 90. Psalm chapter 90. You know, we selected this psalm this week because we know that hearts are heavy in here today. We've lost, of course, a loved one. Brother Harvey has gone on to be with the Lord, and of course, continue to pray for Pastor John and his family, lift them up. But anytime we lose someone that we love, it ought to cause us to reflect on life a little bit. And that's really what this psalm does. Psalm 90 causes us to reflect on the brevity of life. And I think the older that we get, the easier it is for us to comprehend how brief life is. But there's a couple of things that you're going to see in this psalm. There's comfort that we find in this psalm, but there's also a little bit of a warning that we see in this psalm. And the comfort that we find is the fact that we find our refuge, our dwelling place, in God. God who is everlasting from everlasting. He is eternal. And even though we are human beings who have a brief lifespan, if we know Jesus Christ, we know that we will have eternal life in Him. And that is great comfort and great hope for us today. But then there's also a warning, because we do have such a brief lifespan. God does hold us accountable for what we do with the time that we have on this earth. And so the psalm very clearly says that we should number our days. And it says, Lord, teach us to number our days. You know, as I think about the legacy that Brother Harvey leaves here, I know that he did do that. He numbered his days. He raised his family to know and to love the Lord. And you see that in the fruit of his children and his grandchildren. And today we honor him. But we also need to be reminded ourselves to number our own days. So let's read the text together, Psalm 90. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations, before the mountains were brought forth. Wherever you have formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You turn man to destruction and say, Return, O children of men, for 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it is past, and like a watch in the night. You carry them away like a flood. They are like a sleep. In the morning they are like grass which grows up. In the morning it flourishes and grows up. In the evening it is cut down and withers. For we have been consumed by your anger, and by your wrath we are terrified. You have set our iniquities before you, our secret sins in the light of your countenance. For all our days have passed away in your wrath. We finish our years like a sigh. The days of our lives are 70 years, and if by reason of strength they are 80 years. Yet their boast is only labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off and we fly away. Who knows the power of your anger? For as the fear of you, so is your wrath. So, teach us to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Return, O Lord, how long, and have compassion on your servants. O satisfy us early with your mercy, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. Make us glad according to the days in which you have afflicted us, the years in which we have seen evil. Let your work appear to your servants and your glory to their children. And let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us, and establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands. This is the word of the Lord. Remain standing as we lift our voices and worship the Lord through song today.
Yeah.
Sing Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never. Worship. worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your
grateful today for the goodness of God, if you're grateful today for the powerful name of Jesus, say amen. I want to read you something here. This is from the Lilies, Vicki, of course, and Danny. It says, "Dear church family, there's always something to be thankful for, and that is you for me. God doesn't give us what we can handle. God just helps us handle what we are given." And she goes on to say that she is so grateful for all the prayers and the food and the cards, and just helped to make her kidney recovery, surgery recovery, so much easier. And so, Vicki, we sure love you. I think Vicki and Danny are here somewhere this morning. I met them earlier, and they're sitting in a weird place, all right? So, there they are. All right, if you will, take your Bible, turn to 2 Samuel chapter 1. I want to echo that. As many of you know, I guess all of you know now, my father passed away this past week. I was not planning necessarily for it to be this way, but my mom was asleep there on the couch there at the hospice center. By the way, so grateful that our church several years ago pledged to give $25,000 to help build that hospice center. And I said then, had no idea what I was talking about at the time, but I said then we never know when we're going to need it. And of course, this week we needed it. And so we're grateful for that and grateful for our church making that contribution. And but as mom lay there on the couch, I just kind of looked up and we had prayed that dad would pass away very peacefully. I know it doesn't always happen that way, and God doesn't always answer prayer that way, but I will tell you this. I was watching him breathe, and then suddenly he took a weird breath, and he didn't breathe again. And I knew at that moment he was with the Lord. Absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And, you know, I woke mom up, and we just gathered around, and then Greta came over. It was well into the night, and Greta came over, and you know, we're sad, we're grieving, but I'm thankful for Paul's words. He said, "I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope." It doesn't mean we don't grieve. We grieve just like everybody else. It doesn't mean we don't sorrow. We sorrow just like everybody else. But here's the beauty in it. We don't sorrow as lost people sorrow. We sorrow as saved people sorrow, recognizing we are not saying goodbye. We're just saying see you later. And so today, pray for our family. Mama's here today. Last night she said, "I'm not going." This morning she said, "I am going." And so she's here this morning. I know it's tough for her. And I'm thankful for our family that's coming and supporting her today. Thankful for our church family. Your prayers. I mean, we got more food. I'm going to gain 10 pounds just this week. I'm already anticipating it, you know. But y'all have been so gracious to us. And thank you so much for the cards. I spent 2 hours returning texts the other day. And, you know, somebody told me, they said, "Pastor John, you don't have to return every text." Well, I feel like I do. If you took time to text me, I'm going to take time to text you back. And I'm grateful. And if I didn't text you back, it's an accident. Send me another one. I'll send you one because I'm grateful that you took time to pray for us. I'm grateful you took time to send me a text or to send me a card or give me a phone call. It means the world to me. And, you know, just don't know where we're going from here, but He knows. Amen. So we're doing this today. We're more grieved than relieved in 2 Samuel chapter 1. I want you to take a moment. I want you to think with me about something. I want you to pretend that you have a person in your life, and some of you may not have to pretend, but I want you to pretend that you have a person in your life that has slandered you, a person that has assassinated your character, a person that has misrepresented your motives in the worst of ways, and on occasion has literally tried to physically kill you. And then I want you to think about this. As you think about that person, I want you to think about the funeral home calling you and informing you that that person has been killed in a car wreck and that the funeral home and the family is asking you to come and they're asking you to give the eulogy at that person's funeral. Now, once again, this is a person that has maligned you, a person that has misrepresented you, a person that has verbally attacked you and tried to physically attack you, and then the family and then the funeral home calls and says, "We want you to come and we want you to give the eulogy for this person." Ask yourself this question, what would you do? Ask yourself this question, what words would you have to share? Well, today we find ourselves, or David finds himself, as we're going to read, in a very similar situation. We're going to read David's eulogy of King Saul. Now, Saul had become David's nemesis, his arch enemy, as you know if you've been following this story. Saul lived to destroy David, and yet in Saul's death, David, and of course it's in God's grace, it always is, but David, in God's grace, he actually puts all of Saul's malice out of his head, and he delivers a eulogy that highlights only the good points of Saul's life. Now, 2 weeks ago, Pastor Jared addressed the subject, "It's time for a new king." It's time for a new king. Those of you that were here, you'll remember that. His primary application was to put that old destructive king, whatever that king might be in your life. All of us have those kings in our life that should not be there. They should not be enthroned in our life, but we enthrone and we empower those kings. And Pastor Jared so brilliantly brought this out. His primary application was to put the old destructive king or kings in your life to death completely, that the rightful king, and that king being Jesus, might reign supreme. Now, in this narrative, with that thought in mind, we cross over from 1 Samuel over to 2 Samuel, and we read that Israel's destructive king, which is Saul, he has died, and now David, the rightful king from the right tribe, the anointed king from God, he can begin to reign over God's people. Now, something that you may not be aware of, David was actually anointed king 3 times. David was anointed king as a teenager. We don't know exactly how old he was, but we remember how Samuel came down in 1 Samuel 16, and he anointed David king just as a young shepherd boy. But it was like 13 or so years later before David was anointed again. As we've been working through this story, I don't know that we've covered this or not, but David as a teenager begins running. He does not become king at all until he's 30 years old. So at 30 years old, David is anointed in Hebron, and he's anointed just over the tribe of Judah. 7.5 years later, David, at the age of, we assume, 37 years old, depending on how old he was when he was 30 years old, how many months into 30 years old he was. So we're assuming around 37, no more than 38 years old, David is anointed king over all of Israel by the elders. So he's been anointed king 3 times in his life. And as we work through this narrative, we'll understand why. But today, we're going to once again discover God's glory in David's story. God's glory in David's story, especially in David's refusal to gloat and to celebrate in Saul's death. You remember, this whole series is simply entitled God's Glory in David's Story. Even in the bad stuff, all things work together for good. We understand that from a New Testament perspective, that all things are working together for good. The sinister things, the sinful things, the sorrowful things, all of those things are being weaved into a tapestry by God Himself. And so as David is emerging out of this 13 years or so of being a fugitive, we see God's glory still working in David's story because he does refuse to celebrate. And he does refuse to gloat when he could have, and probably nobody would have blamed him. When we arrive here in 2 Samuel chapter 1, David returns from his war with the Amalekites. And here's the thing, Israel at this time simultaneously had been at war, as Pastor Jared brought out, with the Philistines. So David does not know that Saul has committed suicide. David knows nothing about that. The reason he doesn't know is because he has been disconnected to that particular battle. David is fighting the Amalekites. Saul and Israel are fighting the Philistines. David has been disallowed by Achish, as we talked about a few weeks ago, to fight with the Philistines against Israel, which actually was an act of grace on God's part, not allowing him to do that. So David is back in Ziklag. But on one particular day, David looks up. And as he looks up, he sees a man coming over the horizon. And he turns around. So who is this? It's an Amalekite, and he's approaching Ziklag. Now, is this guy crazy? Does he not even understand that David is at war with the Amalekites? Here comes this Amalekite guy. He comes up into the camp there at Ziklag, and you say, is this guy crazy? I say, yes, he is. And he's going to get more crazy as we move through. So let's begin today by looking, first of all, at the eyewitness. The eyewitness. If you will, look at 2 Samuel chapter 1, and if you will, look at verses 1 through 3 with me. Now, it came to pass, after the death of Saul, when David had returned from the slaughter of the Amalekites, and David had stayed 2 days in Ziklag, on the third day, behold, it happened that a man came from Saul's camp with his clothes torn and dust on his head. So it was, when it came to David, that he fell to the ground. The Bible says he prostrated himself there. And David said to him, where have you come from? And so he said, I have escaped from the camp of Israel. Now, it seems very clear that this Amalekite, and we read that he is an Amalekite in verse 8, but it seems that this Amalekite is attempting to pass himself off as a sincere mourner, to pass himself off even, as we'll see in a few moments, as a hero. Plus, he wants to put himself in a position where David would view him as an ally that he respected, and more importantly, probably, one that he would be protecting. So his clothes are torn, as was a customary mourner would do, and he operates under the assumption that he is the bearer of good news for David. What he is very soon to realize, and it's going to come as a shock, what he's very soon to realize is that David's heart is much more different than other leaders. This guy is used to a certain kind of leader. He's used to a person like Saul as a leader, a person like Achish as a leader. He doesn't understand a man after God's own heart. And so he comes up and he thinks he's the bearer of good news for David. And what he is soon to realize is that David's heart is much different than what he's used to. What this Amalekite assumes will be received by David as good news is actually going to prove to be just the opposite. But here's the eyewitness. Amalekite guy comes up. He's got an idea. He's got a plan. Notice the embellishment, and it's a big one. Look what the Bible says in verse 4. Look what he says. Then David said to him, "How did the matter go? Please tell me." And the Amalekite answered, "The people have fled from the battle. Many of the people are fallen dead." And watch what he says here. This is where he thinks he's about to ingratiate himself. "And Saul and Jonathan, his son, are dead also." So David said to the young man who told him, "How do you know that Saul and Jonathan are dead?" Then the young man who told him said, "I happened by chance to be on Mount Gilboa. There was Saul leaning on a spear, and indeed the chariots and horsemen followed hard after him. Now when he looked behind him, he saw me, and he called to me, and I answered, 'Here I am.' And he said to me, 'Who are you?' And I answered him, 'I'm an Amalekite.' He said to me again, 'Please stand over me and kill me, for anguish has come upon me, but my life still remains in me.'" So watch what this Amalekite says. He says, "So I stood over Saul and killed him because I was sure that he could not live after he had fallen. And I took the crown that was on his head and the bracelet that was on his arm and have brought them here to my Lord," or in other words, to David. Now, for those of you who were paying careful and close attention 2 weeks ago as Pastor Jared was preaching, you are already thinking right now, "Wait a minute. Hold on just a minute. That is not the account of Saul's death that Pastor Jared read to us in 1 Samuel chapter 31. And you would be correct. That account recorded that Saul fell on his own sword and that Saul committed suicide. So here's the big question. What in the world is this Amalekite talking about? And that's a good question. And here's the easy answer. Apparently, this Amalekite wanted to ingratiate himself to David. And what better way to do so than by taking credit and claiming to be the one that took the life from the man who for so many years had wanted to kill David. In truth, Saul killed himself. Saul committed suicide. But remember, David does not know that. David was not involved in that battle. So this is all news to him. Now, somebody saw it, and somebody knew it, because we have record of it in 1 Samuel 31, and we have record of it in 1 Chronicles chapter 10. So clearly, though, the Amalekite is lying, at least about how Saul died. Now, some of this is true, obviously, but as far as how Saul died, the man is lying. And here's the thing. He brought evidence with him that he truly did come across King Saul. He brought evidence with him that he truly had encountered King Saul in some way, shape, or form, because the Bible tells us he has his crown and he has his bracelet. Now, parenthetically, I do want to ask this question, because this is something I want to know. Why in the world did Saul have his crown on in the first place? I mean, you talk about just putting a bullseye on you. If you are the king, the last thing you do is you wear your crown and you wear your bracelets that identify who you are, because that's who the people are going to come after. But you got to remember, at this point in time, Saul is not exactly in his right mind, and he's not exactly thinking clearly. He's very arrogant, and he's very foolish. Why he had his crown on his head? Well, that's taboo. Kings aren't even supposed to do that. You're identifying yourself as a target. Just a question of mine. Have no idea. We have the eyewitness. He's an Amalekite. He's coming to the camp. He says, "David, here's what's happening." We have the embellishment, and a big embellishment. He doesn't say Saul killed himself. He said, "I killed Saul." Now we see the exasperation. Notice how David responds in verse 11. David says this in verse 11. "Therefore, David took hold of his own clothes, and he tore them. And so did all the men who were with him. And they mourned and wept and fasted until evening for Saul and for Jonathan his son, for the people of the Lord and for the house of Israel, because they had fallen by the sword." David stands there And perhaps he's got Saul's crown in one hand. Perhaps he has his bracelets in the other. We don't know. But our Bible more than indicates that he tears up. And the Bible says he rips his clothes in mourning. Now keep in mind, Saul is the one that has been trying to kill him for some 13 years. I'm guesstimating there. That's my speculation. But for some 13 years that Saul has been trying to kill David. Now it's completely understandable to everybody here that Saul obviously would mourn Jonathan. But we'll see momentarily, he actually sincerely grieves over Saul as well. And again, this is not some kind of manufactured weeping. This is real grief from David's tender heart. David is completely exasperated over the events that have led up to this. Think about the events that have brought this, the antecedents that have occurred before this that have led David to this place. He's had conflict over Saul for over a decade. He's had conflict with Achish a couple of times over the king of the Philistines, or Gath. His conflict with the Amalekites as they came into Ziklag and stole all his stuff and took all of the people, and he had to go back and fight and had to get them back. And now Saul and Jonathan have died. So David is overcome with grief. And you would think, you know, this Amalekite, as he's looking at it, and maybe you yourself, you would think, well, if Saul's dead, David should be relieved. And the title of our message today is he's more grieved than he is relieved. He's more grieved than he is relieved. And there are reasons for that. You know, as we look at this, you know, as our title indicates, he's grieved at Saul's death. And probably no one is more surprised at David's reaction than the Amalekite. The Amalekite is probably entering the camp thinking to himself, I'm going to go up to David. I'm going to tell David Saul is dead. I'm going to tell David I killed him. And here's the reaction I think that he wanted. He wanted David to praise him. He thinks David's going to be rejoicing. He thinks David is going to be doing jumping jacks and cartwheels. And the reaction is so antithetical to what he thought. David is ripping his clothes. The men are ripping their clothes. They're mourning over David. They're over Saul. They're mourning over Jonathan. They're mourning over Israel. This is not what he thought was going to happen. And by the way, it's going to get worse. It is going to get worse for this guy. Here is David weeping. David is fasting. David does not rejoice. David does not gloat at the demise and the decease of another. And by the way, can I stop right here and just make an application? Neither should we. Neither should we. I think that we probably need to stop right here, and we need to realize that as believers, when someone among us falls, every one of us should weep together. Too often when somebody that we don't like experiences a moral failure or even experiences a death, we tend to gloat and take pleasure, because if we're not careful, if it's somebody that we just really don't like, remember how we started this message? What if you were asked to give the eulogy of that person? Somebody we don't like. If we're not careful, ladies and gentlemen, instead of having the heart of David, we'll have the heart of Saul. Listen, if Saul had received word that David had died, you better believe he'd be doing cartwheels. He would have rejoiced in that, because he was self-centered and he was arrogant and he was foolish. But David has a different heart. David has the heart of God. And here's the thing about David, and here's the thing about God. God's heart mourned over Saul. And because David had a heart just like God's, David mourned over Saul. It's not gloating. Ladies and gentlemen, today it should never be, no matter how we feel about the person. If they have a moral failure or if they have a tragedy, even if they have a death, we should never step back and say, oh, well, they got exactly what they deserve. Thank God for that. I can't really see Jesus taking that attitude, especially when our Bible says it's not his will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. It's not Jesus' will that any man would die and go to hell. It's not his will. And yet we ourselves have probably at times thought that person deserves to die and go to hell. Well, I got news for all of us. We all deserve to die and go to hell. And so we need to stop, and we need to take some inventory, and let's be introspective for a moment. And if somebody else is hurting, even if it's somebody you do not like or that don't like you, man, don't stop and gloat in it. Just realize, but for God's grace, that there go I. That could be me. So David here, he's got a heart for God. He's got a heart for God. Don't step back and say, well, they got exactly what they deserve. Listen, if we are, you notice our banners over here. Let's not forget these. I know these have been up. I try to move these around from time to time because I know many of you, you know, you grow blind to it. You know, you come in, well, I've seen those before. Let's not forget this. Let's not forget Matthew 4:19. Let's not forget the fact that Jesus said, follow me, and I will make you to become fishers of men. But see, here's the thing. If we are following Jesus, then we're going to have the heart of Jesus sooner or later, because what's going to happen is, as we follow him, he's going to form us to have a heart like his and to respond. And then we will be focused on what is important to him. So in this passage, an Old Testament example to some degree is David following God. And God continues to nurture within him a heart that's like his. And then David becomes focused on exactly what God wants him to do. And so today, ladies and gentlemen, if we are following Jesus, we're going to be formed to act as he would act, and we're going to be focused on his objective in that person's life. And his objective is not to gloat. His objective is not to attack. His objective, ladies and gentlemen, is to restore. I don't think I have this for you today, but I think Pastor Jared used this verse a couple weeks ago, Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. Our Bible tells us, oh, we do have it, okay? Brethren, if a man is overtaken in a fault or in a trespass, you which are spiritual. Now, you'll notice what happens here. Paul qualifies who is actually doing this. He says, you who are spiritual. That means a spiritual person is going to involve themselves. This is a person that's following Jesus. This is a person that's being formed by Jesus. This is a person that's going to be focused on the objective of Jesus. You who are spiritual, a disciple. Brethren, if a man or a woman is overtaken in a fault or a trespass, you which are spiritual, he says, restore such a one in the spirit of gentleness or meekness. Watch this. Considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. Isn't that a mouthful? Number one, if a person is overtaken in a trespass, regardless of who it is, if a person is overtaken in a fault, regardless of who it is, whether you like them or not, whether they like you or not, you which are spiritual. If you're not spiritual, you're going to gloat. If you're not spiritual, you're going to attack. If you're not spiritual, you're going to say, well, they got exactly what they deserve. That is not what Paul is teaching here. The Holy Spirit is using Paul to give us a principle here that we need to follow, and it's this. If you are a spiritual person, if you are following, if you are formed, and you are focused with Jesus, you are going to reach out and restore that person in whatever way that you can, with a heart of gentleness, a heart of meekness, understanding that that could be you except for the grace of God. Understanding that whatever's going on in their life could be you. Whatever failure they've had could be you, could be me. And so we stop and we acknowledge that could be me. How do I want people to react, and how do I want people to respond to my failure, to my pain, to my agony, to my trauma, to my tragedy, to my shortcoming? How do I want people to respond? And I believe if we're following and we're being formed and we are focused on the heart of God, we'll be like David. God mourned over Saul. God mourns over other people's tragedy. And ladies and gentlemen, can I just say this? So should we. So should we. We should be weeping over it. We should be restoring that person, and we should be considering ourselves, because it could be us. It's very problematic. It's super problematic in the church when believers, God's people, rejoice in the demise of another person. It's horrible. In Saul's case, the time for Saul's restoration had passed. David knows that. David weeps nonetheless. Hey, David had made attempts to restore Saul. Do you remember back in 1 Samuel 24 and 1 Samuel 26, on two occasions, David could have killed Saul. And instead, David spares his life and then speaks to him and tries to speak life and light into him. He tries to bring restoration to Saul's heart. He says, hey, I'm not trying to kill you. I'm not your enemy. I'm not. I don't want to kill you. David exemplified God's heart towards Saul in hopes that he could restore Saul. It didn't work, but David doesn't have to give account for what Saul does. David gives account for what he does. All the people that have done you wrong, you don't give an account for how they did you wrong. You give an account for how you react to how they treated you. David mourns Saul, and David mourns the death of his sons. He had sons that died, of course, Ahinadab and Melchishua, and especially, though, Jonathan. Jonathan, his dear friend. You know, what is grief? All of us have experienced it, and we're going to. Grief is this. If I could give you the best definition that I know of, grief is the high price that we all pay for loving somebody. Grief is the high price that we all pay for loving somebody. Everybody in your life right now that you love, that have become integral parts of your life, that have made investments in your life. And by the way, your grief is going to always be in proportion to the investment that you've made in their life and they've made in yours. Grief is different. Grief is at different levels. A person that has invested in you and a person you have invested in, your grief is going to be to a higher level because it's always going to be in proportion to the investment that you've made in each other's lives. But grief is the high price that you pay for loving somebody. And some people have even gone as far as to say this: I'm not going to love anybody because I don't want to have to go through that grief. That's not living. That's not living. Some people I know, that you've been through so much pain, you say, I'm just never going to love like that again. Well, if you're not loving, you're not living. Grief is a high price. But grief is, that price is worth paying so that you can live in love, and so that you can love people. So don't stop loving people. David loved Jonathan. David loved Jonathan. They were the best of friends. We'll talk about it momentarily, but they were the best of friends, and David is going through this grief. It's a high price that he's paying because they loved Jonathan so much, and they had invested so much into each other. David, no doubt, had hoped that Jonathan would accompany him in his reign, but sadly, he realizes now that's not to be. So David grieves and he weeps, but then suddenly something occurs. And what's about to happen, unless you've read ahead, you ain't going to see this coming. This is totally incongruous with what you think is going to happen. By the way, it's totally out of line with what the Amalekite thought. It seems to come out of nowhere. Here's David. He's torn his clothes. He's weeping over Jonathan. He's weeping over Saul, Saul's sons, weeping over Israel. And then suddenly it's almost like a bell rings in David's head and he thinks, wait a minute. Wait a minute. The execution. Look at verse 13. Then David said to the young man who told him, the Amalekite, he said, where are you from? And he said, I am the son of an alien, an Amalekite. That is not a good thing, by the way. So David said to him, how was it? Watch this question. How was it that you were not afraid to put forth your hand to destroy the Lord's anointed? David's thinking in his mind, wait a minute, Saul is God's anointed. I myself had reason to kill him from a human perspective and had opportunity to kill him and did not for this reason. He is God's anointed, and even though I am the king elect, I will not touch the Lord's anointed. And here comes this no-name Amalekite and suddenly is gloating and he's bragging and, you know, he's saying, I killed Saul. And David said, wait a minute, who are you? Where are you from? I'm an Amalekite. And here's my question to you then. How was it that you were not afraid? That's God's anointed. How was it that you were not afraid to put forth your hand to destroy the Lord's anointed? Don't you have respect for God? Don't you have respect for God's anointed? And watch what David does. Then David called one of the young men and said, go near and execute this Amalekite. Execute him. And the Bible says that they struck him and he died. So David said to him, your blood is on your head, for your own mouth has testified against you, saying, I have killed the Lord's anointed. Now, isn't that interesting? David says on two occasions, I didn't even kill him. I mean, if anybody should have killed him, it should have been me. I'm the king elect. So David has the Amalekite killed. And here is the total irony in this. And you've probably already picked up on this anyway. But the total irony in this is that the guy didn't even kill Saul. Here is the guy. Can't you see him saying, hey, I was kidding. You know, too late for that. You brought a crown. You brought bracelets. You said you killed him. Of course you're going to say that you're kidding. See, at this point, David still thinks the Amalekite killed Saul. And so David said, who do you think you are? I'm an Amalekite. Who told you you could kill the Lord's anointed? And so David has him killed. And the guy's saying, hey, I was kidding. I was kidding. I take it back, you know. Too late for that. He already testified against himself and brought the evidence to convict himself. And he didn't even do it. How many of y'all believe this plan might have backfired just a tad? Anybody with me? So now, in David's defense, even if this man had been able to make a case of his innocence, his fate had been sealed hundreds of years before because of his ancestors. I'm going to read this to you just as kind of FYI. But you go back to Deuteronomy 25 and look at verses 17 through 19. Remember what had happened. The Amalekites had ambushed the children of Israel as they were coming out of Egypt. And God didn't forget about it. Remember what Amalek did to you on the way as you were coming out of Egypt, God says. How he met you on the way and attacked your rear ranks, all the stragglers at your rear, when you were tired and weary, and he did not fear God. Therefore it shall be, when the Lord your God has given you rest from your enemies all around in the land which the Lord your God is giving you to possess as an inheritance, that you will blot out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. You shall not forget. And so already when this guy introduces himself as an Amalekite, he is not in good company. This Amalek, I think we all agree, this guy should have just stayed home on this day. Should have just, you know, cut his losses and went home. But we've seen all of those things, the eyewitness, the embellishment, the exasperation, the execution. This is where I want us to land today. Very briefly, let's look at the eulogy. Because I want us to see how David handles Saul's eulogy. Now remember, David is a warrior, but before he's a warrior, he's a writer. Before he's a warrior, he's a writer of songs. He's a writer of poems. He's a writer, as we read this morning, of psalms. In this funeral poem, I see four standouts that I want to quickly observe. Number one, the remembrance. Notice what David does. The Bible says in verse 17, David lamented, and with this lamentation over Saul and over Jonathan his son, he told them to teach the children of Judah the song of the bow. Indeed, it is written in the book of Jasher. Here it is. The beauty of Israel is slain on your high places. How the mighty have fallen. Clearly in these verses, here's what David chooses to do. Instead of maligning Saul, what he does is he chooses to remember Saul's successes. Saul, as a young man, he had some great success. Saul had been anointed and the Spirit of God would come on Saul, and Saul had prophesied and Saul had some great victories. When Saul was younger, he was an obedient king. He experienced the power of God's Spirit. You'll notice that David never alludes to Saul's downfall. What he does is he calls Saul the beauty of Israel. What a compliment for the man that has been trying to kill him for 13 years. He's the beauty of Israel. So number one, the remembrance. He remembers Saul's good days, and he doesn't even allude to anything else in Saul's life. Number two, the reticence. David calls for some silence on something in verse 20. Notice what he says. He says, tell it not in Gath. Remember, Gath is the land of the Philistines. He says, tell it not in Gath. Proclaim it not in the streets of Ascalon. Lest the daughters of the Philistines rejoice, lest the daughters of the uncircumcised triumph. Here's what David does. He's more or less instituting what we would call today a gag order. He's saying, do not speak of this. David calls for no one to propagate about Saul's death as something to rejoice over. David says, don't tell it. Don't go in these places and tell it. Don't propagate it. Don't gloat in it. Don't rejoice over it. David did not even want to give the enemies of Israel any satisfaction whatsoever from Saul's death. You remember, as Pastor Jared brought out, they had already done horrible things. And so David is saying, you know, hey, we're not going to talk about this. David was very patriotic. David was very loyal. David was very godly. He stayed loyal to Saul even when Saul did not deserve it. In Saul's death, he is still being loyal to the Lord's anointed. Notice thirdly, the relationship. Look at verse 21. O mountains of Gilboa, let there be no dew nor rain upon you, nor fields of offerings, for the shield of the mighty is cast away there. The shield of Saul, not anointed with oil, from the blood of the slain, from the fat of the mighty. The bow of Jonathan did not return back, and the sword of Saul, the Bible says, he does not return empty. Watch what he says. Saul and Jonathan were beloved and pleasant in their lives, and in their death they were not divided. They were swifter than eagles. They were stronger than lions. Now, I want you to think about the triangle of this relationship, because it's very strange and it's very unique between Saul and David and Jonathan. Look what, I think I have it on your screen. Bring that up, that next frame up, if you would, please. Jonathan and Saul, this is their relationship, son and father. Jonathan and David, best friends. David and Saul, enemies. So it's a very strange triangle as we see here. Saul had actually thrown javelins, though, at both David and Jonathan. Now, you remember, David ran, but Jonathan stayed. But here's the interesting thing. Jonathan remained completely loyal, although he stayed with Saul, and he honored Saul. Jonathan remained completely loyal to David, even though Jonathan knew that he himself was the rightful heir from a human perspective. Wrong tribe, but the rightful heir from a human perspective. That Jonathan stayed loyal to David to the point that he did not care that he was the rightful heir in the people's eyes. He understood that David was the rightful heir in God's eyes. And so Jonathan lost his life, but through it all, he maintained his character. I'm just reminisce just for a moment in 1 Samuel chapter 18, because I want you to remember Jonathan's heart. I think it's important that as we look at Jonathan's death, we remember what Jonathan and David had shared. Now, when he had finished speaking to Saul, the soul of Jonathan was knit to the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. This is who David's losing. Saul took him that day and would not let him go home to his father's house anymore, talking about David. Then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan took off the robe that was on him. See that? The royal robe of being the king's son. He took his robe off and he gave it to David. And he gave him his armor, even his sword and his bow and his belt. This is the heart of Jonathan saying, I know I'm the rightful heir according to Saul's bloodline. However, I know that you have been anointed by God, which supersedes anything else. And so I myself am submitting myself to your leadership. I am your friend. I'll love you to the end. That's the kind of person that David is losing here. David honors the relationship he shared with both men. And then this is what he does, though. He honors their relationship to each other. You notice what he says there. He goes back and he talks about the good times. And he talks about the things that had happened in battle. In verse 23, go back and read it again. Saul and Jonathan were beloved and pleasant in their lives, and in their death they were not divided. They were fighting together. Even though they didn't agree on David, they were fighting together. They were not divided. And watch how he describes them. He says, they fought bravely together till the very end. They were swifter than eagles. They were stronger than lions. So David, he alludes to the relationship. And then lastly, the respect. Look at verse 24. O daughters of Israel, weep over Saul. Now let's talk about something just for a moment, because we want to put this in perspective. 13 years before, what were the daughters of Israel doing? Saul has killed his thousands. You remember that song that they hit? It hit the hit parade. Saul has killed his thousands. David's killed his 10,000s. But you see what's happened in David's life now. David now, he's a different person. I'm sure back then when he was a teenager, that was cool. Back then there was a song written about him. Back then he'd killed his 10,000s. But you'll notice what he does here 13 years later at age 30. He's lived a little bit of life. He's experienced some trauma. He's experienced some self-inflicted failure. And so David here, instead of saying to them, yeah, sing my song, lift it up. That's not what he's saying. You notice what he says in verse 24. He says, O daughters of Israel, don't sing my song, weep over Saul. And this is what he does. He actually just goes back and he starts talking. This is incredible. He says, don't you remember? He clothed you in scarlet. Saul did some good stuff. He clothed you in scarlet. He gave you luxury. He put ornaments of gold on your apparel. How the mighty have fallen in the midst of the battle. Jonathan was slain in your high places. And David says, I am distressed for you, my brother Jonathan. You've been very pleasant to me. Your love to me was wonderful, surpassing even the love of women. How the mighty have fallen, and the weapons of war have perished. Now, David's a new man. It's obvious. He's humble. He's been humble through life's experiences and life's mistakes. So David puts an end to his old song, and he says this. He said, what I want you to do is I want you to lift up your voices, and I want you to weep over Saul, because he made you rich, and he made you prosperous at one time. In essence, David calls for Israel to pay respect for the fallen king. And then David mourns Jonathan. A friendship and a bond that was so strong that David considered to surpass even the love of women. Now let me be very clear about this. David is not alluding here to a homosexual attraction to Jonathan, as some people have suggested. That is clearly not true. Clearly not true. And by the way, I don't say this to be crass. I'm just saying it to be truthful. If you think for a minute that David was a homosexual, follow his life, you will see he is not. Somebody say amen. David liked the women. Somebody help me here. All right? So if nothing else proves that, the rest of David's life proves that, and we'll talk about that, and that's kind of the darker side. But the truth is, David had a very strong friendship that connected on a very deep level of loyalty. Max Lucado describes this kind of death. He says it's a death that amputates a limb in your life. It's a death that amputates a limb in your life. Some of you know the feeling of when a death literally I shouldn't say literally, but figuratively, removes a limb in your life. If you've ever met anybody, you've ever talked to anybody that has lost an arm or lost a leg, here's what happens when they go and they have that amputation. When they come out, they start to do something they had done before in the way that they had done it before, and then they realize, I can't do it that way anymore. There's even phantom pains that they feel. If they lost a leg, they feel it in their foot, but it's not there. This week I lost a limb. I mean, as I'm thinking about this week I lost a limb. And I don't even know yet to what degree that this is going to affect me. Emotionally, it's wrecking. But it's like this. It's like every time I go to do something, my dad was connected in some way to most everything that I do. And so now I've got to learn how to do it a different way. I have to learn how to get up in the morning a different way. I have to learn how to have Thanksgiving a different way. I got to learn how to have Christmas a different way. It's an amputation. Now, people compensate. It's incredible what people learn how to do. I know a guy right now that can put up a ceiling fan faster than I can with one arm. And I'm not kidding. He compensates. But David has lost a limb. David anticipated Jonathan going with him. And now he realizes Jonathan's not going with him. But I got good news for David. God's going with him. And I know there's some of you that are grieving just as I am and just as I will. And I know that many of you have lost an arm or you've lost a leg, figuratively speaking. And your grief is real. And you're having to learn how to do things differently now. Because those people play such a vital and integral role in your life and everyday life. But I say this to you today, and I'm preaching to myself. They're not going any further with me, but God keeps going. God keeps going. The question begging to be asked is this: how could David be so quick to honor Saul instead of malign him? Early on, perhaps David had discovered what Jesus had proclaimed 1,000 years later, and I give it to you today. It's probably a passage that has helped me more than any passage in the Bible. It's in the top five. It's this: judge not that you be not judged, Matthew chapter 7. Here's David. David could have judged Saul, and rightfully so. But what he does, and David's doing this before this has been written. I mean, this is 1,000 years in the future. But David, I think, is realizing, you know, I'm not going to judge Saul. By the way, here's the thing. You know, well, let's read this. For with what judgment you judge, you will be judged. And with what measure you use, it will be measured back to you. Now, you know, if we would stop before we say things, and we would stop before we attack, and we would think, you know what, the standard I'm holding that person to is going to be held to me, I think we would pause for a moment. And Jesus says this: why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but you don't consider the telephone pole in your own eye? Right? Think about this. How can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck from your eye, and look at that big plank that's in your own eye? Jesus says, hypocrite, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you'll see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's eye. And the principle is more or less this. As I said before, David realizes, man, I have failed so much. Here's the thing. Think about this. David already has a telephone pole protruding out of his eye, and ladies and gentlemen, before his life's over, he's going to have a redwood protruding out of both eyes. So David, as he's moving forward, he just looks around and he sees Saul and he says, you know what? Whatever standard I hold him to is going to be held to me, so I'm just going to honor him. Ladies and gentlemen, today, can we learn from this? It's not that we don't call sin sin, because sin is sin. It's not that we don't call it out. It's not that we don't identify it. It's just that we don't hold ourselves above ever having the potential to do it. We still call sin sin, and we should call sin sin, and we should preach against sin, ladies and gentlemen. We should. However, don't ever put yourself above being able or capable or potentially capable of doing the same thing. And David is there, and David could have said, Saul did this, and Saul did this, and Saul did this. And said, David said, I'm not doing that. I've already had my own sequence of failures. I don't even have my life. I'm about to be anointed king, and I'm just a mess. David's a mess. So David, at this point, he's no longer a teenager who enjoys hearing the song about him from the younger women, because he realizes, I ain't all that. I ain't all that. He's 30 years old. He's come to grips with his own potential to fall flat on his face. And David says, I refuse to judge Saul, and wisely so. David had failed God so incredibly up to this point, and it's going to get worse as he goes through life. So he's basically saying, I don't have time to criticize Saul. I got enough trouble keeping this one straight. Can y'all join with me on that? I don't have time to be criticizing everybody else, because I got enough mess going on right here that I need to be dealing with. And that's where we need to be. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12 says it well. Therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed, lest he fall. So the closing questions that I give you today are these. How do you deal with the failures of others? How do you normally deal with the failures of others? Are you quick to judge? If you're quick to judge others, try this. Be quick to judge yourself first. Be quick to judge yourself first. Become very introspective. Take regular inventory. And then ask yourself if you are the real arbiter of truth that you're making yourself out to be. Last I checked, there's only one arbiter of truth. His name is Jesus. He said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. John 17:17 said, his word is truth. Sanctify them through your truth. Your word is truth. That is absolute truth. He is the arbiter of truth, and he is the only one that is worthy to judge. And so today, number one, how do you deal with the failures of others? Are you the person that sneaks off and has secret prayer meetings about them but never get around to praying? Here's what we like to do as believers. When we want to share something that somebody else has done, we spiritualize it. We call people over and we say, we really need to pray for so-and-so because they did this. And it's like, how come it is that when you do that, you never actually get around to praying for so-and-so? How many times have you heard somebody say, we need to pray for so-and-so, but they never get around to praying? All they do is gossip about it. It'd be a great day in our lives when our hearts really were broken over what happened to so-and-so, and we really did get on our faces and pray. Remember what David said? He said, don't spread this around. Don't spread this around. Don't give the enemy the opportunity to get involved in this and to capitalize on this. Don't spread it around. That's what David said. Number one, how do you deal with the failures of others? Number two, how have you dealt with your own personal failure? How have you dealt with your own personal failure? I know I'm talking to people today, and you might say, Pastor John, I am just a mess. Well, how about this? Join the crowd. Say, I'm a mess. Well, that's why Jesus died, was to fix your mess. You might be full of guilt. You might be full of shame. You might be holding your past against yourself. I want to remind you of something. Jesus died that you could leave your past in the past and you could walk on in victory, as we sang this morning, victory in Jesus. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus has given you victory over your sin. You say, well, Pastor John, I still struggle. That's what 1 John 1:9 is about. Just keep confessing that sin before God. The greatest failure of all is the failure to never trust Jesus. And if there's somebody here today and you say, Pastor John, I've never trusted Jesus as my Savior. I don't know Him. He doesn't know me. I don't have a personal relationship with Him. This morning, I want to introduce you to Him. He says He will save you if you call on Him. And all God's people say, let's stand together. Lord, today, I pray that You would help us, first of all, to learn how to deal with our own sin. God, I pray that we would see ourselves as a sinner saved by the grace of God, not as one who is fit to judge others. Lord, I know that we are to call sin, sin, and Lord, we will continue to do so as long as You give us breath. But God, help us to also understand that when a person's overtaken in sin, Lord, it's not for us to judge, it's for us to restore. So God, I pray that You would help us to forgive others, and help us to forgive ourselves as You have forgiven. Lord, help us to walk in victory. God, I pray for those that are in grief and in bereavement. God, many people still struggling in our church with this horrible disease called cancer and other diseases. And Lord, I just pray that today, Lord, that you would give them a special strength. God, I pray today for my friend Jeff Dinkins. God, I pray that today, Lord, that you'd strengthen him. God, give him a special strength today. Lord, as he comes in here and others, Lord, coming in, Lord, and they're in pain, and yet, Lord, they want to be here and worship you. Lord, I thank you that they're able to do that, overcome that, Lord, through your strength. And Lord, others that have come in, Lord, not even knowing, Lord, where their next breath is going to come from, and yet, Lord, they're sitting here in the house of God. Lord, give them strength. God, bless them for being here. Lord, for that person that don't know you as Savior, God, reach down into their heart. God, draw that person to yourself. Lord, be very careful to thank you and to praise you. Would you take a moment as Brother Chuck plays right now? Number one, would you look at yourself? Would you acknowledge your sin? Acknowledge your failure? Acknowledge the power of the cross, that Jesus died, that might be taken away from you. Whether it be in salvation or just be in your continuous journey, right now, put that sin under the blood of Jesus. Forgive yourself as he has forgiven you. Acknowledge it as what it is, but let Jesus' blood cover it. He's atoned for it if you're a believer today. He wants to save you. If you're a believer today, he wants to continue to strengthen you. Allow him to do that right now. And then, after having acknowledged your condition, would you take a moment and would you ask yourself this question? Am I treating others as Jesus has treated me? Am I forgiving others as Jesus has forgiven me? Am I gloating in people's demise, or do I weep over it? Take a moment. Take a moment. Can't think of a better song for us to sing this morning. If you don't know Jesus as your Savior, please come. I'll be right over here. I just want to introduce you to him. He's made the difference in my life. He'll make the difference in yours. For the rest of us, let's just come and let's just say, Lord, I come and I confess. This is what I am. I'm a mess. Let's do that this morning.
Lord, I need you. Oh. So teach my soul to rise to you. When temptation comes my way,
and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you.
Jesus, you're my hope.
Could this morning, church, what I'd like to do, I'd like to invite Pastor John and his family down here to the front, if you guys wouldn't mind coming down here. And deacons, wives, if you would join me this morning, I'd like to take just a special moment, a time of prayer over their family. So deacons, wives, if you would, make your way down to the front. And then once they make their way down here, I'd like to invite our church family, if you would, just come gather around. Let's pray over this family this morning.
Lord, we thank you so much for the power of the gospel. Lord, that we can kneel here and know that Harvey is with you. And God, we just praise you for that. Jesus, we thank you for going to the cross and paying our sin debt so that we could have life. So that we could be with you, that we could be reconciled. And Lord, we just praise you for the testimony that Harvey has, that seen through his family, and how he has led many to you just through his life and through the family that follows you, Lord. And there's no greater legacy in life than a family that has become disciples and follows you. Lord, we lift them up to you today. Give them the strength and the grace that they need. Lord, we know that you have grace that never runs out. It's not like we're going to look to you and you say, I don't have any more grace. We're so thankful that you give it to us. And Lord, I pray that you would help this family as they grieve. Help us as a church. We praise you for the power of Christ. In Jesus' name we thank you. Amen.
Thank you, church. Just a few announcements that we need to make before we dismiss today. We do have D groups meeting today. I know we have rescheduled some things and the schedule's a little bit different, but we want to thank everybody for being flexible this week. There are SRQs out on the Welcome Center desk, so make sure you pick those up on your way out. We also want to celebrate this week, of course. Jeff and Kelly Wood have had their baby, London, and just super excited for that. We are currently trying to help them with meals. And so if you would, just check out the Facebook page where you could sign up to help take Jeff and Kelly a meal. That would be a huge blessing to them, I know. For our launch students, we do have our fall retreat coming up November the 12th through the 14th. I want to highly encourage you to sign up for that. The cost is only $30. That's going to cover all your meals, the lodging for the weekend, and we will have a blast. So get a form to me, filled out by your parents, and turn in a deposit as well. A couple other announcements. We do have, we're currently in the middle of our Gospel from the Gospels evangelism strategy or campaign for this fall. And we will be having our next equipping session for the month of November on October the 31st. And we're going to meet at 9:30 a.m. in the Kids Clubhouse. I highly encourage you guys to participate in that. Pastor John will be covering how we can use the minimal facts to be able to share the gospel with people in that session. We also have, we will be having our vote for the youth pastor candidate. We are presenting, of course, Jared Bowman as our candidate for the youth pastor position here at Peace Haven. And that vote will take place on October the 31st in the morning service. We will have him here with us next Sunday evening for a Q&A session right before our chicken stew. We'll have our chicken stew next Sunday night. He will be here at 4 o'clock. We're planning to do that in the kids' clubhouse. So what we are asking you to do, if you plan to be here for that Q&A session, we did put a sign-up on our Church Center app. So if you could, please let us know that you plan to be here for that Q&A session with Jared. And that will be, like I said, at 4 o'clock next Sunday evening. You can sign up for that through the Church Center app or see me afterwards and I can get you signed up through the app as well. And then lastly for me, do we have another couple of announcements? Okay, you know what? I'm going to save this one. And then if you guys want to come and make an announcement, then I'll come back up.
Choir practice is at 4:15 today.
Okay, so it is that time of year again where we get to invest in our community through Trunk or Treat. As of right now, we only have 10 trunks, and for this to be a successful night, we need about 14 more. So if you're willing, you can sign up at the Welcome Center. Candy donations can also be dropped off at the center back there. And if you don't, if you're not able to supply your own candy, we can do that, and we can also restock when you fill out. Share the link on Facebook for the event so we have a good turnout. Thank you, guys.
Okay, the last announcement that I have here, many of you probably know just a few weeks back, Rick and Wendy LeVan had a house fire, and if you've ever known someone or if you've ever had a house fire, it can be pretty devastating. Even if the house doesn't burn to the ground, the smoke really ruins a ton of stuff. And just having to recover from that is a huge deal. So this morning, what we'd like to do, we'd like to ask our church family on your way out if you, we want to take up a love offering for Rick and Wendy this morning, basically. And there's a couple ways you can do that. I have some envelopes in the back that I will ask. Kimberly, can you get those to maybe Roy back here, usher in the center aisle? And if you would like to have an envelope, you have cash that you want to make designated for Rick and Wendy, just pick up one of those envelopes and write that on the outside of the envelope. Or even if you don't have a pen, just put it in the envelope. We'll know what it's for. But we also created an item on the Church Center app. So if you like to give through the Church Center app, you can do that. And there is a designation there on the Church Center app for Rick and Wendy LeVan. So you can give through the Church Center app as well. Of course, if you write a check, just put in the memo line for Rick and Wendy, and that way we can keep all that separated as we give today. So I know that would be a huge blessing to them, and we're just so grateful for you guys, Rick and Wendy. We love you guys, and we just want you to know that. That's everything I have, Pastor.
John Basilio, so good to see you, man. Always glad to have you back. John got saved at our church and doing good, man, doing good. So also, you might want to designate on your check for Rick and Wendy's legal fees. They're living in a small little camper right now, so they'll be getting divorced pretty soon as well. And so they may, Rick said, so far, so good. You know, he told me this morning, so far, so good. But I know it's a struggle, you know, and we're just going to laugh through it, but we're going to cry through it as well. But we just want to help you, and we love you guys. Y'all been faithful to this church and to your God. And thank you so much for your investment. Shane, come here, man. This is Shane Younger. Shane has come today by statement of faith. Shane actually got saved. I got to lead Shane to Christ in his driveway about 6 years ago, wasn't it, Shane? Yep, 6 years ago, and he got saved here and got baptized here as well. And so he comes here today as coming by statement of faith. Do I have a motion that we accept Shane into our fellowship today? Brother Jeff Miller, do I have a second? Jamie Colbert, all in favor by an upraised hand? Any opposed by the like sign? And Shane, if you'll stay right here, if y'all will come around, welcome Shane at our fellowship. God bless you. You are sent.